Well, here we are again. This is Brother Peter with tidbits from the Word. So proud to be with you today. Do you know that Jesus, I was talking about earlier, came in the flesh to walk on this earth to show several things to human beings? And one of the things was that he was going to show was that the first Adam sinned because he allowed the devil to trick him into it and entice him into it. I actually think that Adam was smart enough to know that the sin that he was going to do was going to give him Eve in the flesh, and that is his downfall, was his downfall. And so therefore, man is weak. Man is very weak. Jesus came to show you that man could be very strong, even in the flesh, if he would take the initiative to do so. Yet, a man could be perfect in the flesh and yet not die and go to heaven. So it's the spiritual realm that carries a man's soul to heaven. This body is eventually going to end up in heaven, but it's only going to end up in heaven if the soul goes first. The soul and the body of a saved person are attached forever. The soul and the body of a lost person are attached forever, but they're attached in and reserved for hell fire forever in torment. And the Bible said the worm dieth not. That is the soul and the body of a man that is lost, that dies and goes to hell, that perishes off this earth without accepting Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. Now, I'd spoken a while ago in another excerpt about Jesus coming and walking on the earth. Now, he's going to be the teacher, the mentor, and the leader, and the lever of the Holy Spirit that would go into all people at one time. Now, while he was walking on the earth, he carried all of the Holy Spirit there was to carry. And when he went to heaven, he left that Holy Spirit. He sent one. He said, the Comforter will come and comfort you. Acts 1 and 8 said, tarry, wait now until you be endued with power from on high. In the flesh, we could not talk about Jesus. In the flesh, we could not talk about God. In the flesh, we could not go out and witness or preach a message or talk to somebody. A lost person is not going to come talk to you about Jesus. Only a saved person. Only a person with Jesus in their heart can talk to you about what they have in their heart. And remember, when Jesus went to Nazareth, we looked a little while ago in that other one, and when he went to Nazareth, he said a prophet is in his own town is not welcome. And that's one of the battles that I have fought for years. I got saved here in this area, and I'm in my own town. I turn around, I come back, and I'm prophesying the truth. The last prophet was John the Baptist, so I am not a prophet, but I am a prophesier of the Word of God, and because I study it, and I know it, and I could be a prophesier of math, I could be a mathematician, and I tell you the truth about math, and if you've never heard it, to you, it's new. And so, all right, the Beatitudes. Jesus came to Galilee, and he preached a sermon. One of his second sermons that he preached after he started walking, after he came through Nazareth and he started walking across the country, and the disciples and the people were there, and Jesus was on a mountain, and he, in Matthew 5 and 7, and the light, Jesus was light. He was true light. He was the light of the world. And the world received him not, by the way, but he was the light of the world. And he wanted to teach them how to have humility. He wanted to teach them, as a period of time went on, how to pray. And he wanted to teach them the difference between heavenly and earthly. And he wanted to teach them between the difference between earthly treasures and heavenly treasures. And that was the beginning of his ministry. Now remember, Jesus is working with people. He's working with 12 disciples from 12 different sects of all of the land. 12 totally different mentalities, education-wise. Peter was a rough old fisherman, and some of them were doctors and lawyers and tax collectors, and just a mix, a hodgepodge, if you please, of 12 men. And do you know what? They ended up all in one accord. They ended up all in one accord in the upper room with 120 were there. The Bible said, and when they were all in one accord, the Holy Spirit fell. I can see this picture. You want me to show you a picture of what I see? You take 12 guys from any church, I don't care, your church you're in, you go out and you just walk through there and you say, you and you and you and you, and you take these 12 guys and you put them in a round table in a room and you throw a subject up and see what you find for agreement and disagreement. You say, we're going to tear this building down and build a new one. Why? The one that said that, 11 men might jump up and say, no, you ain't. And they're going to have problems with each other. So here's Jesus. He's got 12 apostles. And there's 120 in that room, by the way. And they're women, too, and men. And as they're in there, it's going to take 10 days for the Holy Spirit to come in. The Bible said when they're in one accord, the Holy Spirit came. Do you know what? I bet you old Peter had to say to John. I bet he had to say, hey, John, you remember when I got mad at you a month or two ago? I kind of held that against you. Forgive me. And old John had to say to Andrew, you remember when I did this or that, or you did this or that? You know how we disagreed with each other? And then each one of them had to go around, 120 in the room. There had to be some apologies made. There had to be some reckoning done. And when the reckoning got done, all the hearts became in one accord and everybody's hugging everybody's neck. There's some tears going in. There's some real remorse there. I'm talking about real. And everybody said, look, I want to start fresh and new, and I don't want this between me and God and me and you. And so I'm going to start over. And then Jesus said, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit in now. And he sent the Holy Spirit in and filled them. Do you know how you know what something has to be before you can fill it? It has to be empty. If it's not empty, you could top it off. But if it's empty, you can fill it. Jesus came and filled them with the Holy Spirit. And they left that room immediately. I tell you what, when I got saved, it was as immediate as turning a flashlight on that I was out witnessing. I went home and witnessed to my wife first, told her what happened. She didn't believe it. Oh, no, she didn't believe it. We'll see. We'll see. She said, we'll see. Well, she did see. It's 40 years later, and it stuck. And I am saved. Listen, when you get saved, it will be immediate. You really get saved, it's going to be immediate. You're going to tell somebody. You really get saved, you're going to tell somebody. It's a brand new life. It's brand new. And all of the ashamedness and hidden things come to light. And God took a weight off of me that was pounds, thousands and thousands of pounds of weight. God took off of my back. Listen to what Jesus said when he in the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. The thing of tithing said, if you will tithe, give 10%, one dime of every dollar that you make belongs to God. $10 of every 100 belongs to God. If you make $300 a week and you do not put $30 a week in the church house, the storehouse, you say, well, all they want down there at church is all they want is my money. Well, come over there to my church where we got a $1,600 a month light bill. Come over there where we have a $3,000-$4,000 a month overhead in paydays and things. Come over there where the grass has to be mowed at $400 or $500 a month. Where somebody has to come and work on an air conditioning at $1,200 or $1,500 a lick, and Hey, think about it. Here's a church that I go to that probably costs $7,000, $8,000, $10,000 a month minimum just to keep the doors on. And you say all we want is money? No, we don't want money. All God wants from you is your 10%. If you make $1 and you bring one dime and put it in a tithing envelope and put it in the offering plate, you did the exact same thing as the man that put $10,000 in. One dime is the same as $10,000 on your salary. Obedience, the Bible said, is better than sacrifice. You ain't got to put a penny more than your 10%. Now, that is your required offering. Your required tithe. Your offering is if you decide to put anything above and beyond that. And I have people that help me. I'm a Bible pastor out there, and I give out Bibles and Christian books and things. And it takes a lot of money. And I have people that put on their tithing envelope money for Bibles, and that money goes into Bibles, directly into Bibles. Doesn't go into stuff to benefit me. Goes into stuff to benefit the class and those around me. And so Jesus said, blessed and merciful. Now, we got off on the tithing, and I'm going to say this. Now, in your life, if you show mercy, you'll have mercy. And that's what he's saying. There is a principle in the scripture that says what you give, you will get. If you're a grumpy, ugly old person, you're going to get grumpy, ugly old return. But if you're a blessing and a giver, he said, blessed is them that obtain mercy. Obtain. Let me tell you what obtain means. That means to grow in it. You grow in mercy and grace. It's not something you just get. You have to work at it. You have to look at it. When you ride down the street, do you have mercy on what your eyes see? If you see somebody in trouble, would you stop and help somebody in trouble? That's what mercy is. It's 106 degrees out there, and there's a woman standing out there, or a man standing out there with a flat tire. Would you stop and help them? Would you have mercy on that situation, or do you just drive on by? Where is your mercy today? You can gauge pretty much your spiritual life by your mercy. All right, listen to this. He said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. How can you get pure in your heart? You can only get pure in your heart. Romans 10:9-10 says, if you will believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, thou shalt be saved. That's where the purity comes in. 3 o'clock in the morning, November 5th, 1972, I got a pure heart. And my heart has grown purer since. It never could be any purer than it was, but what happened is after I got saved, and I was 100% pure that morning for an hour or two, I did some things that took on a likeness of the same things I did before I got saved. I had to work on those things, get them out of my life, and therefore open the door in my heart to the rooms that I tried to keep. I tried to keep them room or two after I got saved. And I always said, hey, you can't have that room. I got to have it. I either got to have all of you or none of you. So I want all of you. And all right, so he got all of them. He said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. I want to see God in his purity. I want to see him to say, well done, good and faithful servant. I don't want him to have to say to me, depart from me, I never knew you, you worker of iniquity. Wow, what a shocker that's going to be for some people who may be even preaching the gospel today or sitting in a church. Listen, if your salvation is in your works, you're not saved. If your salvation is in your baptism, you're not saved. If your salvation is in anything other than the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ and believing that he did it all and you can do nothing except ask for it. It's a total free gift, but you have to ask for it. And when you ask for it, he gives it to you, and from that moment on, you're saved forever. You say, well, man, what do you mean you're saved forever? What if I sin? You will sin. 1 John 1:9 said, He's faithful and just forgive us if we sin. I've got to go. My time passed. And I'll see you in the next excerpt.